let him take the floor from here. So what's going on? Thanks for being here. Yeah, thanks. Well, thanks for being here, friends. This is obviously a topic that a lot of us are wrestling with. I know that it's a time of life where you're beginning to try to form your own convictions and insights around sexuality, and also just a time in our culture, in our church, when there's a lot of anxiety around the topic of sexuality, particularly on campuses, I think. So obviously, with a topic this vast, I'm not going to be able to address all the issues or all the questions, but here's what I'd like to do. I'd like to share a bit of my story with you. I'd like to point you to a couple of biblical passages that have helped me get to grips with this theme of sexuality, and then basically I want to throw it open for questions. And let me just say up front, no question is a bad question. I don't think you can offend me. So ask whatever you feel urgent, feel is an urgent question. I'd be happy to talk about it and share my perspective and hopefully point you to some scriptures that could share insight on it. So you've already heard a bit from me, but I want to tell you a little bit more about myself. I was raised as a Christian. I grew up in a Christian family near Little Rock, Arkansas. And I was one of these church nerds as a kid. We went to a Baptist church. Baptists in those days, I'm assuming a lot of them still do this, but we were in church at least three times a week. Sunday morning church, Sunday night church, and Wednesday night church. Youth group events. So that was my life. And I was just immersed in it. My earliest childhood memories are of hearing my parents read me sort of illustrated Bible storybooks. I was drawing pictures of David and Goliath and Daniel in the lion's den from a very young age. And when I was, around 5 or 6 years old, I remember coming to my parents and saying, I know I already go to church, but I want to pray and ask Jesus to come into my heart, be my Savior, be my Lord. So I prayed that prayer and really kind of grew up. I had doubts and struggles like all of you, but I never really doubted that Jesus was who he said he was. That he lived a perfect life, that he died on the cross for our sins to reconcile us to God, that he rose from the dead, that he was God in the flesh. I could see that that was the center of my parents' life. I could see that it was the center of my youth pastor's life, who I really loved, and I wanted that. I didn't resent that. I was very happy to be a Christian. But what was also happening to me, as I was getting to age 13, 14, 15, I had this really close group of friends, all of whom were guys, and they began to, we were all going through puberty at the same time, and they began to talk about girls that they were finding attractive for the first time, sort of awakening to their sexuality. And I realized as I was listening to them have these descriptions that what they were saying was not what I was experiencing. It wasn't what I was feeling. And I realized I certainly didn't have language for it at the time. I grew up in a pretty small town, pretty sheltered environment. As far as I knew at the time, I didn't know anyone else who was gay or lesbian. So those words didn't immediately come to my mind. But what I realized during those teenage years, those early teenage years, is that when a friend who was a guy that I sort of had an interest in, a crush on, would walk in the room, my heart would start to beat faster. I sort of would notice when he was in the room, and I felt drawn to want to talk with him and get to know him more. I felt attracted to him physically. And none of those things were happening for me with girls, but that was happening again and again and again with guys. Not with all guys, but with many guys who were my age. And I think I initially just kind of intuited that this is not something I should tell my parents about or my friends about. I don't think anyone said to me, you should feel ashamed that you're having these experiences, but I kind of absorbed that from the environment. And so I just kept it all a secret. And it took me a few years to realize that, oh, I think what I'm experiencing is what a lot of people mean by gay. I think that I'm gay. I think that I'm experiencing same-sex attraction or homosexuality. And, this was around the years 1997, 98, 99, well before gay marriage was legal in this country, well before a lot of churches were talking about it as much as they are now. And so I sort of felt like I was wrestling with it alone, in many ways. I knew that my parents loved me. I knew that my youth pastor cared a lot about me. But there was some block in me that I felt like I can't confide this in them. I can't talk about this with them. And although I was a devoted Christian, there was also a kind of block in my relationship with God where I felt that, you know, even though I'm not sleeping around, even though I'm not really dating anyone, even just having the feelings inside is enough to make me really displeasing to God, dissatisfying to God. So I wrestled with shame. And I remember at the time, you know, all the Christian books you could find on the topic, there weren't a lot, but the ones that you could find seemed to be addressing different kind of issues and different kind of questions than the ones that I had. I was very much asking, you know, what does it look like to be, to have a close relationship with my friends? What does it look like to navigate these feelings of attraction? But a lot of the Christian books were about sort of fighting for quote-unquote traditional marriage in the political sphere. A lot of them were addressed to people who had been very involved in gay communities and were now trying to go into heterosexual marriages and have children. And I just didn't identify with a lot of what was out there because I felt, you know, I've never been really a part of a gay community, and I've never really been very political. So what do I do? How do I live my life as a Christian? And I went to college with those kind of questions. And I went to college kind of pseudo-hoping that I would never have to talk about this with anyone. If you had told me at age 18 that I would be doing this today, I would have laughed and said, absolutely, no way, will that happen? And I remember kind of thinking and worrying and praying, you know, could it be possible that maybe this is a phase? You know, maybe people's sexuality changes and if one day I'll experience opposite sex attraction, I'll get married, have a family. I mean, those were all the questions that were swirling around in my mind. And I got to college and I began to, you know, ask some girls out on dates and they were wonderful women, and we had great conversations, but there was never that spark of physical and sexual and romantic attraction. They felt like good friends, they felt like sisters, but they didn't feel like people that I was romantically drawn to. Meanwhile, you know, I kept developing crushes on guys, and I kept, you know, kind of developing you know, feelings, romantic feelings, physical attractions for guys, and I just lived with that kind of distance until it became kind of difficult to keep going. And I just felt depressed, I felt stressed about it. And I remember sitting down with a friend of mine in our college dining commons one day. And she had been a good friend. She was on my, she was in the same dorm as me. And we had done some things socially together, but I didn't know her all that well. And we sat down to lunch and she kind of said, Wes, I want to tell you about something kind of serious in my life. And I said, sure. And she said, for the last few months, I have been battling really severe depression. And it's been very hard for me because it's not been something that fits with my image of myself. I've always thought of myself as a really kind of successful, can-do sort of person. And I've just been debilitated by this depression. And she said, it finally dawned on me that I was trying to deal with my depression by just suppressing it, burying it, and hoping that it would die for lack of oxygen. And it didn't die, it just kept rearing its head. And she said, I realized about 6 months into this experience that ignoring is not the path to redeeming. And that sentence stayed with me. Ignoring is not the path to redeeming. And I didn't say anything to her that day about my sexuality, but I realized that I walked away from that lunch with that phrase kind of rattling around in my brain. Ignoring is not the path to redeeming. I had been trying to cope with my sexuality by ignoring it, by burying it, by not talking about it, by kind of disdaining it, being afraid of it, hoping that it would go away, and it wasn't going away. And I felt that perhaps that conversation with my friend was God's way of prodding me to talk about this with someone that I trusted. So I kind of looked around me and I said, who do I trust? Who is safe for me to talk to about this? I was about 21 years old. And I had a professor. I went to a Christian college, and so all of our professors were professing Christians. And one of my professors just struck me as a really, really wise, very—he was someone who was familiar with suffering and complexity of life. And he had a fascinating story himself. When he was about 16 years old, he was riding in his backyard one of those zip lines, and he fell like 10 to 15 feet and broke his back. And so he was partially paralyzed, disabled, and he would walk with the assistance of a cane or a wheelchair. And he talked pretty openly about how he lived with chronic physical pain as a result of this accident, even into his adulthood. But he also was very open about emotional pain and the complexity of that. And he said to us, he said this in class one time. He said, one time I was facing a temptation when I was in my 20s that felt so overwhelming that if I didn't give in to this temptation, the whole world would go dark and I would not be happy at all. And I remember hearing him say that, and I thought, this is a guy who gets it. This is a guy who understands the intricacies of the human heart. This is a guy who understands how confusing and painful life can be. And I think he'll be a safe person for me to talk to. So I made an appointment with him, and I don't know if you've ever done this. It was one of those emails where you intentionally keep it vague so that you can back out at the last minute if you need to. I wrote the email and said, I need to talk to you about something really serious, but I didn't say what it was. And so I thought, even if I took it out and decided I don't want to share, I can make up some other thing that it was about. So I went to his office that day, and I'm sure I was like bright red, and I really struggled to get the words out. But I said, I'm attracted to men, and I'm a Christian, and I don't think those things go together, and I'm confused, and I don't know if I can live a Christian life this way. And I've often told people the first gift that my professor gave to me that day was the gift of not being surprised. Some of you have heard the name Francis Schaeffer. Francis Schaeffer says, he has a statement where he says, Christians should never have the reaction designated by the term shocked. We should never be shocked by anything life throws at us. Why? Well, because we have a story that is so honest about the human condition that we can admit anything and not be taken off guard by anything. I mean, if you really believe that God created the whole world, that God created you, that God knows how many hairs are on your head, that you are radically broken by sin and death, and that Jesus has come to give his life to make you new. I mean, if you really believe that, there is nothing that life can throw at you that should shock you or totally throw you off kilter, because that is a story that is big enough to inhabit with all of your problems and all of your fears and all of your struggles. God is the creator. Humanity is radically broken, and Jesus has come to make us new, both now and for eternity. That's the story that we're part of. So my professor gave me the gift that day of not being shocked, and he said to me, he said, Wes, I can't answer all of your questions. I can't tell you whether God going to have you get married one day or not. But what I can tell you for absolute sure today is that God loves you and that I want to meet with you again, that we are not going to let this be the last word. So I began to meet with him. I began very slowly, the very first time in my life as a 21-year-old, to learn to talk about the things that I had kept secret for a long time, for years and years. I kept secret even from the people that loved me the most. And it was a very gradual process. And I had a lot of questions. I mean, one question, which I know probably many of you are asking, is what exactly does God say about homosexuality? What does Scripture teach about sexuality? That was a big question for me. Another big question was, if God disapproves of same-sex relationships, and I'm gay, what does that mean for me? What does that mean for my future? Do I hook up with guys and then feel perpetually guilty? Do I commit myself to sexual abstinence? And then do I feel lonely the rest of my life? How do I make sense of this? Those were the kind of questions that were on the front burner for me. And I went to one of my pastors, and we started to meet once a week and to pray together and to search the Scriptures together. And I just want to share with you a little bit of that process today. I want to share with you some of the conclusions that I've come to from God's Word. And then I really do just, I'm serious, I want to throw it back to you and invite any questions. And again, to reiterate, there is no bad question in any of this. So be thinking of what might be your questions that you want to raise. But I'd like to take you to two scriptures, if I could. And the first one is from the Gospels. So if we could turn to Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 19. A lot of people say in our culture that, well, Jesus didn't really speak about homosexuality, right? So, you know, we don't really have to have an opinion on it if we're Christians. And I think that's, yeah, that's one of those yes and no things, right? Yes, technically, Jesus did not address homosexuality, but no, Jesus did talk about our creation as male and female and our sexuality. Jesus does have a vision for what it looks like to flourish as a sexual being. And I want to take you to this story. It's a story that we see a lot in the Gospels where the religious leaders are trying to trap Jesus. They're trying to catch him in a mistake so that they can discredit him and basically like cause him not to be as popular with the crowd. So that's where we are in Matthew 19. And verse 1 says, "Now when Jesus had finished these sayings, he went away from Galilee and entered the region of Judea beyond the Jordan. And large crowds followed him, and he healed them there. And Pharisees came up to him and tested him by asking him, 'Is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any cause?'" Now, the reason that's a gotcha question is that divorce was a very controversial thing among Jewish people in Jesus' day. You had some that had a more lenient view that divorce was allowable for a lot of different reasons. And then you had other views that divorce was not allowable, except in a very small number of cases. So they're basically trying to get Jesus to take sides so that he can be caught in an argument, so that he'll be kind of discredited, as I said. And look at what Jesus does in response. It's very interesting. In verse 4, Jesus answered, "Have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female? And said, therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate." The first thing I want you to notice about what Jesus does here is he doesn't start from what the current practice is. I think that's really crucial to notice. In other words, Jesus doesn't say, well, let's approach this question by just looking around at what the habits of the culture are. That's what we'll do. He doesn't do that. He says, have you not read? In other words, have you not gone back to the Old Testament and looked at what it says about what God's original purpose was? So in other words, he's leapfrogging over what the current debate is. And he says, I'm not going to let the terms of the cultural debate set the terms for my views on this. I'm going to go back to what God revealed in the beginning in Genesis and let that guide me. And he says, what you read there is that God created male and female for each other, for a covenant of love with one another, so that they're no longer even two. They're now one flesh. Now, the Pharisees aren't going to be satisfied with that so quickly, because they come back to him and they say, look at this, verse 7. They said, well, why then, Jesus, did Moses in the law of Moses, the Jewish law, why did Moses command one to give a certificate of divorce and to send her away? And that's their trump card, because they can point to a chapter and verse in the law of Moses where it says divorce is allowed. There's actually a verse there that you can point to. And they feel like, aha, they've got Jesus. You know, Jesus is now contradicting Moses. That's a problem. But look what Jesus does. He said to them, verse 8, because of your hardness of heart, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives. But from the beginning, it was not so. Now, friends, I think that is really, really crucial to notice what Jesus is doing. Jesus is distinguishing between two times in history. He's saying there's a time where God is basically recognizing that we all have hard hearts. And he's saying divorce is permissible in light of your sinfulness, in light of your hardness of heart. But from the very beginning of history, that was never the intention. That was never the goal of what it means to be a sexual creature. And now that I'm here, now that I'm bringing the kingdom of God, Jesus says, we're not just going to take our cues from what human hardness of heart allows. we're going to go back to the beginning and we're going to try to live in accordance with what God designed us to be. And you say, well, how is that even possible? It's possible only because of Jesus. Jesus is now bringing in the kingdom. Jesus is now ushering in a new way of being human. He says, your righteousness doesn't need to be where the Pharisees and the scribes are. Your righteousness is going to go deeper and broader and wider than theirs because I am your Savior. I'm the King who's bringing in the kingdom now. Now, I just think that's a framework that Jesus is giving us for thinking about all kinds of sexual brokenness. I mean, we can look around us and say, well, look, I mean, there's people that marry people of the same sex. There's people that prefer multiple sexual relationships. There's people that have all kinds of other sexual preferences, including, you know, solo sex and pornography. I mean, surely we live in a sexually plural culture, and there are different ways of being sexual that God's okay with. I think Jesus' framework would suggest no. Jesus' framework would say a lot of what we currently see in the world is not what God intended. It's the result of human hardness of heart. It's the result of a humanity that has collectively turned away, fallen away from God's original purpose and pursued the devices and desires of our own hearts. And if we're going to think clearly as Christians, we can't just look inside and be true to what we find there, or look in the culture and be true to what we find there. We actually have to go back to the beginning and see what has God revealed and allow that to stand in judgment over what we currently experience. Does that make sense? That's what I think Jesus is doing in Matthew 19. Well, I found myself, kind of to my chagrin, kind of reluctantly agreeing with that. When I began to meet with my pastor, I said, yes, God does have a design for human flourishing. And the more I read Scripture, I mean, I don't have time to unpack it today, but when you look at the passages where Scripture actually addresses same-sex sexual behavior, they are uniformly, without exception, negative in the Bible. The reason they're negative is because, I think, as Paul spells this out in Romans chapter 1, particularly clearly, they miss the mark. That's the language Paul uses. They miss the mark of what Jesus calls the beginning. There was a beginning design. There was a beginning goal for human flourishing. And same-sex sexuality, same-sex sexual intimacy is, it's something that many people practice. It's something that's been legitimized and accepted in many different cultures around the world. But theologically, from Jesus' standpoint, it still is a missing the mark of what God's original design was. I found myself believing that. I found myself compelled by that. Like I told you, I wanted to be a Christian. I wanted to submit my opinions and my ideas to God's word. And I found that as much as I tried, I couldn't wriggle out of what God's word was saying about sexuality. So that raised a second question for me, a really urgent question, and this is where I want to take you to one other passage. The question was, how in the world is it possible for someone who's gay, like me, to live into that vision? I went to a Christian college, and one of the things that you find when you go to a Christian college is a lot of people get married very, very young. We have this saying that we can, I don't know, maybe other campuses have the same saying, I'm sure they do, but ring by spring, you know, is the saying for the senior year. And it happens for a lot of people. A lot of Christians end up meeting each other on a Christian campus, and I found myself going to wedding after wedding after wedding after, you know, around graduation time. And, you know, each wedding that I went to was sort of it's like a further punctuation on that question mark that I had over my future. Is if everybody else is pursuing a life of you know, sexual intimacy, romantic intimacy with someone that they're going to make a covenant with, they're going to pledge to be there for life in sickness and health, for richer, for poor, what does that mean for me? What does that mean for me if I'm saying, God, I think that your word is calling me to a life of sexual abstinence because I don't think that same-sex sexual intimacy is your will for my flourishing. Where does that leave me? Am I just kind of doomed to a life of loneliness? And I know that 20-somethings can be kind of dramatic. I was pretty dramatic. But I remember praying a lot about this vision I had of of being like a 50, 60, 70-year-old guy going home to an empty apartment every night, throwing in a frozen pizza in the oven, and watching Netflix until I fall asleep, you know? And I thought, that's not the life I want. That's not a life that's fulfilling. I don't want to be lonely. And sort of in my culture, it seemed like the options were either get married or be lonely. And when I listened to a lot of secular voices, they also said the same thing, either get gay married or be lonely. You know, and it began to be a really kind of urgent existential question for me. Is loneliness kind of what I'm stuck with? Is loneliness my lot in life, so to speak? I want to point you to a passage that I think it's been an anchor for me. And I want to suggest that it sort of shows us what God's vision for flourishing looks like. I'd like you to turn to Mark chapter 10, if you would. Mark chapter 10. This is a very famous story in the Gospels. It's the story of the rich young man. If you look at Mark chapter 10, verse 17, here's what it says. It says, as Jesus was setting out on his journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Don't murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother." And the rich young man said to Jesus, "Teacher, all these I have kept from my youth." And Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And Jesus looked around. Remember, his disciples are right there with him. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How difficult it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were amazed at his words. Let me just pause there. Jesus is watching this rich young man walk away, holding on to his wealth, which he can't let go of. And Jesus looks and says, "It's really, really difficult for rich people to let go of their wealth and come follow me and be part of the kingdom of God." And the text says the disciples were shocked by that. They were amazed by that. Why? Well, the reason is, in Jesus' time, often wealth was looked at as a sign of God's blessing, a sign of God's favor. So if Jesus is now saying that it's hard for the wealthy to get in, I mean, what hope does anybody have then? Because the wealthy are supposed to be the blessed ones. The wealthy are supposed to be the ones who, of course, are in. So the disciples are super puzzled by this. And then Jesus says to them again, "Children, how difficult it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." And they were exceedingly astonished. And they said to him, "Then who can be saved?" And Jesus looked at them and said, "With man it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God." And here we come to the part of the story that really interests me. Peter pipes up. If you know anything about Peter in the Gospels, he's the impetuous one. He's the one who is always putting his foot in his mouth. He's the one who goes for it when everybody else is too shy to say what they're really thinking. Peter, verse 28, says to him, "See, Lord, we have left everything and followed you." Now, why did Peter say that? It's because he wants Jesus to know, "Jesus, I know you just said that rich young man is going to find it hard to enter the kingdom of God, but please look at me, because I've left everything behind to follow you. You've got to pat me on the back. I'm surely in," right? In other words, Peter is focused on his own sacrifice, and he's viewing that sacrifice as his ticket, if you like, to get into the kingdom of God. "Jesus, I've left everything behind. Please notice that. Please approve of that, and please view that as my certification to get into your kingdom." And look at what Jesus does. Very interesting. Verse 29. Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house, or brothers, or sisters, or mother, or father, or children, or lands, for my sake and for the gospel, who will not received a hundredfold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. Jesus, in this passage, is recalibrating Peter's mindset. Peter's saying, look at everything I've left behind to follow you. Please approve of that. And Jesus says, you know what? Ultimately, you haven't left anything behind to follow me. Yeah, I know you left your fishing nets. I know you left your fishing business. I know you left your relatives in Galilee. I know you left your family. You left all that behind to come follow me. But you know what? When you follow me, you don't lose anything. You gain 100 times what you left behind. Look around you, Peter. You see all these people standing here? These are your new brothers and mothers and sisters and fathers. Do you see all these kids running around? These are your new children. Do you see all these lands that we're journeying through? This is yours. Everything is now yours in the kingdom of God. You have been inducted into an entirely new community. You've been socialized into a new family. You've been adopted. You're now part of the kingdom of God. You are not lonely. In fact, I guarantee you that you will not be lonely, because I'm going to take you all the way into the age to come. That's what Jesus says. He's totally trying to turn Peter's mindset upside down. He says, Peter, you think you've left everything behind and that's going to leave you sort of in shambles, and you want God to somehow make up for that? I'm going to do you one better. You haven't left anything behind. You've been grafted into a new way of being human, with brand new relationships, a whole web of relationships that are going to be your family. Friends, I have come back to this passage over and over and over again, because what I am trying to do with my life, so I've committed to a life of, I use the word celibacy. I know that's kind of an archaic word. We don't use that word a lot anymore, but I like it better than single. Single to me kind of implies disconnect. It has that connotation of going home to an empty apartment and eating frozen pizzas and watching Netflix. But celibate is this word that means I'm devoting myself to a life of intentional singleness, and intentionally choosing to remain unmarried, not to have sex, in order that I can obey Jesus. And my big fear is that that's going to leave me lonely. But Jesus, over and over again, through this passage in Mark, has said to me, you're not going to be left alone. Look around you, Wes. You've got a new family. You've got new brothers and sisters. You've got new mothers and fathers. You are not ever, ever called to live the Christian life or live the celibate life alone. In fact, if you try, you're going to crash and burn. That's not the goal. The goal is that you are called to love and to be loved. And the lie that our culture has told you is that the only way you can love and be loved is if you're in a romantic partnership. But the gospel actually explodes that lie, because we are called to love and be loved in the community of faith called the church. I'm called to love and be loved by my new mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters. Now, I don't want to paint a rosy picture for you. That is both a gift and a calling. It's a gift. I am the church, but it's a calling in the sense that it's not automatic. I have to ask for friendship, and I have to pursue friendship, and I have to pray that my brothers and sisters in Christ would pay attention to my loneliness and pursue me. I mean, it's something that we're all working on. But I'll tell you that as I've gone on in my 20s and gone through seasons of real loneliness, really painful loneliness, and in my 30s, some of those seasons have continued. But God has provided for me. Just give you one illustration. I remember I was in England one evening in grad school, and I was living in a flat by myself, and I was washing dishes, and my phone buzzed, and I picked it up, and it was my friend Jono, and he said, Wes, we just have this second child. Her name is Callie, and we really want you to stand next to us at her baptism and be her godfather. And the reason we're asking you this is not just because we want you to help us to raise Callie as a Christian, but we want you to be part of our family. We want you to be an uncle to Callie. We want you to be a brother and sister to Megan and me. And, I hung up the phone, and I just said a prayer. I said, thank you, God. I mean, that's it. That's what we're talking about when we say that those who are single are not left high and dry. Those who are committing to celibacy are not left without family. We are called to be family. One another. This is an ongoing process. I mean, I certainly do not have it all figured out. I'm in my 30s now, and I can tell you really honestly, loneliness has not gone away. I don't expect it to ever go away until I'm with Jesus. But there is a way to not remain trapped in it, to not remain sort of curved in on yourself in it. There is a way that you can open yourself up to the love that God wants to give you through and in the community called the church. And that's the life I'm trying to live. That's the life that I think all of us, whether gay or straight, are called to live. Every Christian calling is going to involve both no and yes. It's going to involve no, saying no to what God calls sin. And I think that scripture is clear that same-sex sexual intimacy is sin. But the no is never the last word. My friend Eve likes to say that you cannot have a calling of no. There's never a Christian calling that's built completely around saying no to something. That's not it. That's only half of it. Christian callings are always positive, and mine no less than yours. My calling is to love and be loved in the church. Yes, I'm called to say no to sexual intimacy, but I am not called to say no to love. I'm called to say yes to a life of hospitality, yes to a life of friendship, yes to a life of community, yes to a life of being Callie's uncle, and that's the life I'm trying to live. And I think that places both a gift and a burden in our lives. It places a gift because we know that God's not going to leave us alone, but it places a burden in the sense that we've got to live into that. We've got to pursue that with and for one another. I think I'll stop there. I know that you probably have a lot of questions, and I'm also aware that with a topic like this, there's probably a bit of reluctance in the room about kind of sharing questions, and I would just say to you, please don't feel that. I mean, if you want to come up to me privately afterwards, that's more than all right. I'd be happy to talk just one-on-one if that would be more comfortable, but really, I'm very happy for you to ask any question now, and could maybe somebody just flag me when we need to quit? Jeb will do that. So great. So yeah, let me just throw it open. The ball's in your court. What would you like to ask about this topic or anything I've said today? Any questions? Yes.
While you're going through seasons of loneliness and insecurity, what did it take for you to not isolate?
Great question. Maybe I'll repeat the questions in case everyone can't hear them. Question was, when I've gone through seasons of loneliness, what did it take for me to not idolize human companionship? It's a question that cuts close to home because it's something I come back to again and again. I'm not over that. I think that the temptation when I'm in that season of loneliness is to think, if only I were married, this would go away. Or if only I had a partner, that I would not be experiencing this. And I think what I've come to is the realization that there's a certain sense in which that's just true. I think there's a certain sense in which I probably would be less lonely in many ways if I woke up in the same bed as a partner or a spouse. So I think just kind of being honest with myself about that there is a sense in which some of the loneliness that I feel, some of the loneliness takes the form of, oh man, I really want to say this to someone, but I don't want to say it to sometimes, or I really want to go on vacation, with someone, but I don't know who to ask. I mean, some kinds of loneliness like that, I think, would go away if I were married. But I think there's a deeper kind of loneliness. There's a deeper kind of yearning to connect with real, unalloyed intimacy with someone. And my married friends tell me that deeper kind of loneliness doesn't go away in marriage. It's still there. Even in some ways, I mean, this is painful, but in some ways it can actually be worse when you're married. There's a writer I really like named Lauren Winter, and she talks about two different kinds of loneliness. She says there's the loneliness of the everyday, and there's the loneliness of estrangement. The loneliness of the everyday is, I don't know whose name to put down and ask for my emergency contact at the doctor, or I don't know who to call if my carburetor breaks down, when I'm driving around. I don't have anybody to worry if my plane lands on time. I mean, that's kind of mundane, everyday sort of loneliness. That's the kind of loneliness that can be fixed with a spouse or a friend. But there's another kind of loneliness, the loneliness of estrangement, which is where you may be sharing the same bed with someone, you may be sharing the same house with someone, you may have children together with someone, but you know there's a piece of you, maybe a big piece of you, that you can't share with them because there's some kind of brokenness or there's just some kind of inability to connect at that level. And I mean, that loneliness can actually be even made worse in marriage. So, you know, there's a saying, if you're lonely, don't get married. In other words, don't make the mistake of thinking that marriage is gonna be a magic bullet, a silver bullet for your loneliness. I try to remind myself of that. I try to say, you know, I think there's a certain kind of naivete that I can have sometimes where I think, man, this really hurts if only I were married. And I try to remind myself that actually what I'm pining for is something that probably even marriage can't supply. So what happens then? Well, Henry Nouwen, who's one of my heroes, he was a Catholic priest who died in 1996. He was also gay himself, so I connect with him at a lot of levels. He was a gay man who lived a celibate life. But Henry Nouwen talks about the challenge of being a Christian who's lonely is to learn to transform loneliness into solitude. They're not the same thing. Loneliness and solitude are different things. Loneliness is an ache that one is pining to have filled by human presence. I mean, I remember I used to not be able to go to the grocery store without a friend. That's how bad loneliness was for me. I wanted somebody with me at all times. And I realized that God was saying, you know, there is a kind of solitude that can be fruitful, that can be holy. And part of the Christian calling is to learn, when you're sitting in that place, to not try to medicate your loneliness with other people, but to hold that loneliness before God in prayer and to say, Lord, I know that ultimately I was made for you, that you have made us for yourself, to quote Augustine again, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. And even the holiest, closest, best friendship or marriage that I can imagine would still leave that God-shaped void unfilled. So there's a sense in which I have to come back to there's no real solution for loneliness other than God. And I don't mean that to sound like a cop-out. I have not arrived at this. This is an ongoing struggle for me, but those are just some thoughts. Thanks for that question.
Yeah. Hey, Wes. I put my number on the projector. Oh. If you have like a question that you maybe don't
Perfect.
Feel comfortable just sort of asking
you.
Out, but you would like,
that's fantastic.
Yes,
yep.
You can text that. It will remain anonymous, and I will just ask it.
Thank you. That's a great
yeah.
idea. Thanks, Eric. Yeah. Great question. So when is it appropriate to tell someone that you're gay, or should you not bring it up? I mean, this is going to sound like a cop-out, but I think it all depends. there are certain gay people that I've talked to where if they were to come out, there's a real question as to whether their parents would let them stay in the home. You know, they might actually face real homelessness. So I think you need to be concerned about your own safety. You need to know that if you do come out, you're going to have people that you can turn to if it goes badly. I mean, I remember when I came out to my parents, it was a tough thing. I mean, they're godly Christian people and they love me to pieces, but it was still tough. And I remember I had a couple of close friends that I told. I said, you know, I'm going to come out to my parents on such and such a night. Would you guys please just be available by phone in case, you know, I need to call you and pray and cry and, you know, whatever. So I think be aware of your own needs, be aware of your own safety issues. Having said that, and I say this not meaning that you have to use any certain language. I think you can do it in a lot of different ways. But I think in general, it is healthier to come out than to stay in the closet. And coming out doesn't have to mean coming out to a room full of people like this. It could mean coming out to your Bible study leader or your roommate or, you know, your group of trusted friends. But there's a certain sense in which spiritual unhealthiness flourishes in secrecy. Proverbs talks about he who covers his sin will not prosper. You know, there's a sense in which keeping things hidden is a recipe for spiritual struggle. And I'll just give you an illustration of this. I remember when I was in the closet, I spent so much time really, really trying to appear other than what I was. I wanted people to think I was heterosexual. So I was like obsessed about my mannerisms, the way I dressed, the books I talked about, the movies I talked about. I didn't want to give any possible clue to other people that I was wrestling with my sexuality in this way. And I look back on that and I say, what a recipe for spiritual horrible things. I mean, it was training me in deception. It was like regular habits of deception. And what it was also doing is it was causing me to like hold myself back from other gay people because I didn't want to be associated with them in case other people started to suspect me. So it was actually hindering me from loving people. So I think there's a lot of ways that staying in the closet can contribute to a lot of sickness in our spiritual lives. Now again, let me just reiterate, that does not mean you have to come out and say, I'm gay. You don't have to use that language if you don't want to. You can use other language, like same-sex attracted. It also doesn't mean you have to write a book like I did or speak to a group like this. I mean there's lots of ways to come out. But I think in general, sharing it with at least one other Christian person that can pray with you about it, talk with you about it, be there for you in the moments of pain is a good thing. That's my two cents. Yeah.
So I've talked with some friends who believe that it's not only possible that God does sometimes change people's desires over time. And I wonder what you think about that, whether it's kind of a naive, foolish way of looking at it, or that actually does that.
Yeah. Question is, what do I think about, does God change some people's desires so that they become more heterosexual or opposite sex attractive? It's a really complicated question. So let me just say something personally. So I have a couple of friends, several of whom are open about this. You can Google their names. Kyle Keating would be one. So Kyle is someone who realized that he was bisexual when he was in high school. As he described it at the time, he was more on the gay end of the spectrum. But he ended up, I think it was in his 20s that he met Christy, who he's now married to. And he realized that he didn't have a lot of feelings for women in general, I can put it that way, but he was developing an attraction for Christy. And he said, I can't really explain that. He said, I mostly have gay feelings, but this seems like a genuine attraction that I have for her. And he talked with her about that. He said, how does this make you feel that I'm wrestling with my same-sex attraction? And it turned out she was very attracted to him as well. And they discerned together, they did it very patiently, very carefully, but they discerned that they thought God wanted them to get married. They're married now, they have a child. Kyle does some speaking on this and some writing on this with me. I don't have any desire at all to question that story. I mean, I think where I get worried is when we use a story like that and hold it up as a promise of what God will do for everyone who has same-sex attractions, where it becomes a kind of benchmark, where if I can just get to what Kyle has, then I'll be in God's good graces. Then I'll be basically living a Christian life the way I should be. I worry about that kind of thing. And I worry about it for biblical reasons. I worry about it because it seems out of step with the way God spoke to the Apostle Paul, for example, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul has this thorn in the flesh, which there's a lot of argument about what was it. I tend to think it was some kind of physical ailment to do with Paul's eyes, but there's a lot of speculation. Whatever it was a painful thing. And Paul prayed 3 times for God to take it away. And 3 times is a biblical idiom for a lot. Paul prayed a lot for God to take this away, and the answer he got was not healing. God said, I'm not going to take it away. And what the promise was instead is, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. And I think that is probably going to be the more common experience for people who are gay and Christian, is that God is going to leave us with this thorn in the flesh, if I could put it that way, and he's going to tell us that you're not left out in the cold, you're not left high and dry, my grace is with you, but my grace is with you precisely in your weakness, in your sexuality, not by rescuing you out of it. Maybe I'll just recommend a book. There's a book called Understanding Sexual Identity by a friend of mine named Mark Yarhouse. And this is a book that just tries to explain the evidence. What do we know about people who claim to have their sexuality changed? How credible are those claims? And Mark is just a really careful, godly Christian author, and he kind of basically concludes there are a small percentage of people who talk about shifting. If sexuality is a continuum, you know, with gay on one end and heterosexual on the other end, which is kind of a problematic way to think about it anyway. But if that is the way we think about it, there are people who seem to experience some shifts. But the kind of categorical movement from gay to straight is pretty rare. If it happens at all. So that's kind of my take on it. Yeah.
So I've got a bunch.
Okay, great.
What we might do, we also have Q&A tonight, so I might defer some of them to that.
Sure.
That's okay with the group.
Yeah.
But yeah, so the first one was, our sexuality, gay, straight, or other, is and feels so foundational to our identity, but you say no to your sexual orientation. How have you reconciled these things?
Yeah. First thing to say is I completely understand that. It does feel pretty foundational. You know, I kind of get annoyed when someone said to me recently, well, you know, I had to give up cake for Lent last year or something. I'm like, that's not the same. there's a big difference between giving up sex and giving up cake. So I get that. You know, it does feel pretty foundational. But I think, you know, I really do think Christians, we have to take our cues from Jesus. And as I like to remind people, the guy we worship was a, presumably, in our categories, a heterosexual man going through his 20s and 30s, and he never had sex. And we not only declare him to be our Savior, but we declare him to be the fullest, truest, most alive human person who's ever lived. The reason I say that is because he was without sin. Sin is something that dampens our humanity. It doesn't make us more vivid, it makes us more dull and drab. And he never had that, so he was the most flamboyantly alive, if I can put it that way. He was the most, he was the life of the party. People wanted to be around him. He was a joy to be with. He was full of life, and he never had sex. And I think that our calling as Christians is to allow that life that he lived to critique our cultural myths. And one of the myths that we believe as modern people is that you have to be having sex in order to be fully alive. And I just think Christianity cuts against that myth. I think the life of Jesus cuts against that myth. Jesus was just bubbling over with life and vitality and joy and love. And he lived his life as a celibate man. So I'm not saying that's easy. I do not find it easy at all. I'm pretty sure if I weren't a Christian, I would want a husband. But I feel that I'm so compelled by Jesus Christ. I believe he is who he said he is. And I want to allow his life to continue to call into question my cultural assumption that I have to be in a romantic partnership or I have to be having sex in order to be fully human. I don't think I do. I don't think that's what Jesus teaches. So, yeah.
Maybe I'll do one more and then we'll break for lunch. And we will, again, questions will remain anonymous, but we'll try to bring them back up.
Sure. Tonight. Yeah, that sounds great.
How can we welcome people with same-sex attraction in the church when they're not coming from our same understanding? That understanding sexuality from God's terms leads to more fulfillment than pursuing our own sexual desires. And how do we include them even as we present a message that they may feel excluded by?
Yeah, boy. Good question. So I think as I read our current situation in the church, I think we kind of have a double message that we send. And the message that we send to gay people is, you are welcome, but we can't affirm you. And then the message that we send to straight people sounds different. It is, we welcome you and we affirm you. And I think anytime you have a church that's trying to do both of those things, it's always going to feel lopsided that the gay people are getting the short end of the stick. And the straight people are getting, you know, let off the hook in terms of their sexual lives. So what I think we need to move toward, and this is a process, this is not an overnight thing, but what we need to move toward as a church is where everybody, without exception, whether you're gay, straight, bi, or anywhere in between, everybody gets the message. You are utterly, unconditionally welcome in Christ. The doors are wide open to you. Christ wants to be your Savior, forgive your sins, have a life with you, and not a single person, whether heterosexual or homosexual or anywhere in between, gets to be affirmed. Affirmation is not a Christian category. God never comes to any of us and says, your sexuality is okay. Let me just rubber stamp it. You get to be welcomed and affirmed. Meanwhile, these sexual sinners over here, they get to be welcomed but not affirmed. I don't think that's acceptable in Christian theology. Every single one of us is, we live our lives east of Eden. We live exiled from the perfection that God made us for. And all of us are multiply twisted and misshapen and misdirected, lusting after things, longing after things that we weren't made for. The image that Jeremiah uses in the book of Jeremiah is that we're longing for broken cisterns that can hold no water, cracked wells. We're just trying to slurp up as much water as we can, but there's no water there because the cracks have let it all leak out. That's where all of us are sexually. And so the message that the church needs to be giving to every single one of us is, come, be welcomed by Christ, and come join the life of sanctification, of transformation, of discipleship, where everything you hold dear about yourself is going to be rewired and redirected to love God and neighbor. Now, I think we're a long way from saying that. I think still a lot of our churches seem to imply that straight people are okay and gay people are on the outs. And I think it's part of my calling. I mean, it's part of why I'm talking to you today, because I want to change that. I want to be part of changing that in the culture of the church. I want the churches to be a place where every kind of sexual sinner can come and find healing and welcome and transformation. I'll leave you with one story. Some of you may know the book What's So Amazing About Grace by Philip Yancey, but he tells a really heartbreaking story in that book. He says there was a social worker who was meeting with a woman who was a prostitute, and this woman, in order to make some extra money, had begun, sorry for being graphic, she had begun renting out her daughter as well. And she was at the end of her rope, just totally racked with guilt, and she comes to the social worker and says, what can I do? You know, where can I turn? And the social worker says, have you ever thought of going to church? And the woman says, church? Why would I go there? They have nothing to offer me. They just make me feel worse. And Philip Yancey says in his book, he's been haunted by that story for years, and I'm haunted by it too. Because my fear is that the church has become the kind of place where one can't admit being a sexual sinner because there's this double standard. So I'm praying and working and longing and hoping that we can be a place. The early church fathers called the church a hospital for sinners. A hospital for sinners. That means everybody who comes into a hospital is going to get treated. But you're going to be treated, which means they're going to try to move you on from where you are. So it's a life of unconditional welcome, and it's a life of gradual healing, gradual sanctification. I realize that's a short answer, but that's my best take on it. So thank you so much.